Hello viewers, in our last lecture series on carbohydrates, we had highlighted that carbohydrates are the major source of energy, hence rightly called metabolic fuels. Let us ask ourselves a question, that can life sustain only on the basis of energy? Then the answer is no. There are variety of other macromolecules which play an important role in development, growth and metabolism. Proteins is one of them. Proteins, enzymes which are present in our cell are also proteins. Some hormones, our hair, nails, even hooves of animals are proteinaceous in nature. Not only this, when we talk of silk fiber or cow web, they are made up of natural proteins. So in today's lecture, when we talk of proteins, we are going to start the lecture with amino acids, which are the building blocks of these biomolecules, which are proteins. So let me start the lecture with the structure and history of amino acids. So what are amino acids? Amino acids are compounds which have an amino group and a carboxylic group in the same molecule. So now if I talk of amino acids, then what is the importance of amino acids? That different amino acids react together to form a peptide or a polypeptide, and then this polypeptide folds on itself to give rise to proteins. So that means when we carry out hydrolysis of proteins, we get amino acids. Hence, amino acids are the building blocks of proteins. How do these amino acids react? So what we find here in the reaction that I've shown on the screen, that is one molecule of amino acid will react with the second molecule of amino acid. And what happens in the course of this reaction? Then the carboxylic group of one amino acid reacts with the amino group of the second amino acid to form a dipeptide, and the reaction is accompanied by elimination of water molecule. This dipeptide, which is formed, reacts with another molecule of amino acid, resulting in a tripeptide, and this chain goes on, this reaction goes on till we get a polypeptide chain, which then folds to form a protein molecule. Thus, the formation of the protein molecule from amino acids, that is the primary structure, secondary structure, tertiary structure and quaternary structure, we shall be dealing in great details in our following lectures. So now if I talk of the functions of amino acids, then as I've already said that amino acids are basic constituents of enzymes, hormones, antibodies, antibiotics and the heme, which is the part of hemoglobin. So they play a variety of roles in metabolism. And as I've already said that they are building blocks of proteins. There are 20 amino acids which occur in nature, and these are naturally incorporated into polypeptides, and these amino acids are known as proteogenic or standard amino acids. And when we talk of the alignment of these amino acids to form a polypeptide, they are aligned in a particular manner according to the universal genetic code. So nowadays, almost more than 700 amino acids are known, which occur in bacteria, algae, fungi, and higher plants. But out of this 700 amino acids, only 20 are standard ones. What we mean that 20 are standard ones, that these amino acids are used in protein synthesis. And the other ones are the non-standard or non-protein amino acids, and they play various functions in metabolism. And the most of the amino acids which occur in nature are alpha amino acids. What do we mean by saying an alpha amino acid? Like if I look into the structure of amino acid, which I have shown here, then we can say that amino acids are derivatives of methane. in which one hydrogen is replaced by an amino group, second is replaced by a carboxylic group, and third hydrogen is replaced by a side chain. And the carbon to which the amino group is attached is the alpha carbon. Right, that is the alpha carbon is the carbon which is next to the carboxylic group. So this is an alpha amino acid. If this amino acid was attached to a second carbon, that is the beta carbon, then the amino acid would have been beta amino acid. And if to a third carbon, then it would be a gamma amino acid. But please remember, the amino acids which are used in protein synthesis are alpha amino acids. So we can easily say that amino acids are derived from the methane, in which the three groups are replaced by an amino group, a alkyl side chain, or an side chain which can be alkyl, which can be aromatic, which can be acidic, which can be basic, and a carboxylic group. So what is the main structural feature of amino acids which they have in common is that all amino acids have an amino group, a carboxylic group, and a hydrogen bonded to the same carbon, which is the alpha carbon. They differ from each other only in their side chain group, which is the R group. So when I say that is the side chain which I am showing here, that is the R, they only differ in this. So, and this is the group R which will decide all the properties of a particular amino acid, that is its structure, its size, whether it is polar, it is non-polar, it is negatively charged, it is positively charged, and it will also influence where that particular amino acid is soluble in water and also other physical properties of amino acids. So as I've already said that there are 20 amino acids which are alpha amino acids, and these alpha amino acids, out of these 20 alpha amino acids, 19 alpha amino acids have a primary hydroxyl group, which I have shown in my first structure on the slide. That is the NH2 group is a primary group. So out of 20 alpha amino acids, 19 have this group, which is NH2 group, whereas only one amino acid, which is proline, it has a secondary alpha amino group, which is known as a imino group, I-M-I-N-O. So what is the difference between an amino group and an imino group? A amino group means that the functional group is NH2, that is, it's a primary amino group, whereas imine is NH and it is a secondary amino group. So now when we talk of the stereochemistry of amino acids, then please remember, in nature, all naturally occurring amino acids are L amino acids. This I'll be coming to nature later on. And what I want to tell you here is that in nature, the alpha carbon is attached to four different groups, as I've shown in structure 2. That in this case, carbon is attached to amino group, it is attached to an alkyl side chain, it is attached to a hydrogen and a carboxylic group. Hence, this carbon is chiral, and that means that this amino acid is optically active. Whereas when we look into glycine, glycine is the only amino acid which is achiral, that is, which is not symmetric, which is not optically active, because in it, the carbon is attached to two hydrogens. So the alpha carbon is not attached to four different groups. And please remember, glycine is the simplest amino acid. Now when I talk of asymmetric or a chiral carbon, what I mean here is that when we are talking of a chiral carbon, as I've discussed with you in my lecture on carbohydrates, that means a chiral carbon will give rise to a chirality, or the molecule will become asymmetric. resulting in a pair of enantiomers, and these enantiomers are non-superimposable mirror images of each other, which I had demonstrated in my last class also, that if we look into the hand and I put it like this, then what you have to remember is that the left hand and the right hand are non-superimposable mirror images of each other, hence they are chiral structures. And please remember, you have to remember that all proteins are having L amino acids. It is only, now what I mean by saying that is they are having L configuration. So please remember, when we were talking of glyceraldehyde in the stereochemistry of carbohydrates, there we said that Emil Fischer had taken glyceraldehyde as an arbitrary standard, and he had given assigned configuration to two isomers of glyceraldehyde, one having L configuration and the other having D configuration. What he had done in that case was he had taken the longest carbon chain as the vertical chain with the highest oxidized end on the top. So when we look into the structure of glyceraldehyde, what we find it that the longest carbon chain has been taken as the vertical chain with the highest oxidized end, which is the aldehyde group, on the top. And then we look at the orientation of the OH at the chiral carbon. What we find here is that in which the OH is on the left hand side in Fischer projection was given configuration L, and the one in which the OH is on the right hand side was given configuration D. Similarly, when we talk of amino acids, then we know glycine is the first simplest amino acid, which is optically inactive. Next amino acid is alanine. In alanine, what we've done is we've replaced, that is, we have a methyl side chain. So this has been given configuration in comparison relative to glyceraldehyde. And what we find here is, again, we've taken the longest carbon chain with the highest oxidized end, which is the carboxylic group at the top. And then what we find is that when we look at the orientation of NH2 group, that is the amino group, in one case the amino group is on the left hand side, which is given the configuration L, and in the other case the NH3 group, that is on the right hand side, which has been given configuration D. So that means that we now, when we talk of amino acids, all other amino acids are given configuration with reference to alanine. And what we find in most of the cases, in naturally occurring amino acids, the amino group is on the left hand side. And when we talk of proteins also, then what we find is in proteins also have amino acids which are having L configuration. So now when we talk of the D isomers, it is not that the D isomers are not found. D isomers are also found, but they are found in small amounts in peptides of bacterial cell walls, such as, and the amino acids found there are D-alanine and D-glutamate. And they are also formed in some peptide antibiotics. What is the advantage of the presence of D-alanine and D-glutamate in the cell wall of bacteria? The advantage is that these are not susceptible to enzyme peptidases, as a result of which bacteria are resistant. Now let us look into the classification of amino acids. So if I talk of classification of amino acids can be classified on two bases. First is the nutritional. What do I mean by saying nutritional? We can classify amino acids into essential amino acids, non-essential amino acids, and I have not shown here also semi-essential amino acids. Like, essential amino acids are those amino acids which our body cannot synthesize. And since our body cannot synthesize, it is utmost important that we take them in their diet. Because if we are taking diet which is deficient in these amino acids, we will end up having some kind of diseases. Whereas non-essential amino acids are the ones which our body can synthesize. Now, when I talk of semi-essential amino acids, then semi-essential amino acids are those amino acids which are required during certain growth phase of an individual. That is, for example, in the childhood we may need a particular amino acid, which we may be needing in the adult stage also, but in the adult stage the body can synthesize, whereas in the childhood it cannot be synthesized by the body. Now the second basis for classification is that is we can classify amino acids on the basis of the group, which is the R group, which is we've shown here, which is the side chain of the amino acid. So now if you look into the structure of the amino acid here carefully, then what we find is that all the amino acids will have one amino group and a carboxylic group, and along with this it will also have a alkyl side chain, and this is this alkyl side chain which will give a particular character to an amino acid. So on the basis of this alkyl side chain, an amino acid can be a nonpolar amino acid, like it if it has an aliphatic side chain like a methyl group or an isopropyl group, that is I can say it can be glycine, it can be alanine, it can be valine, or it can be polar uncharged amino acids. For polar uncharged amino acids we can have a side chain which may be having a hydroxyl group or a thiol group. So if I talk of an hydroxyl group, we can talk of serine. And then we can have aromatic amino acids. When we talk of aromatic amino acids, we can talk of phenylalanine. And then we can have acidic amino acids. When we say acidic amino acids, what we mean here is that a amino acid is having two carboxylic groups in it. And when we talk of a basic amino acid, that means that amino acid is having two basic groups in it. And this we'll be discussing later on in great details. So now if I talk of how will I name the amino acids? See, initially amino acids were given common names on the basis from where these amino acids were obtained from. For example, glutamate was obtained from wheat gluten, and this amino acid was given name glutamate. Whereas if we talk of tyrosine, then tyrosine was obtained from cheese, and tyros in Greek means cheese. So therefore the amino acid which was obtained from cheese was named as tyrosine. Similarly, glycine is sweet in taste, and since it is sweet in taste, its name was derived from a Greek word glycos, which means sweet, and hence it was named glycine. Now, how it is very difficult now when we are writing the structure of a polypeptide to write the full names of the amino acids. Like if you have to write, it is very difficult to write like full glycine, then glutamate, alanine, methionine. It will become very difficult. So to make the task easy, what has been done now is that each amino acid is given three letter abbreviations, that is, and a one letter symbol. So now if I talk of glycine, and generally what has been done, that is the first three words of the amino acid have been taken as a three letter abbreviation. So if I talk of glycine, then in that case its three letter abbreviation is GLY, and we represented with one letter symbol, which is G. Similarly, we talk of glutamate, then glutamate is represented by the first three letters, which are GLU. And now again in this case, if I compare glycine with glutamate, the first alphabet is G in both the cases. So what has been done, that instead of taking G cannot represent glycine as well as glutamine. So what has been done, for if we are taking G for glycine, which is representing G, then the alphabet E is taken to represent glutamate. So if we see GET, supposing, so then what we can say is that this particular tripeptide has glycine, glutamate and tyrosine. Now let us look into the history of the amino acids and what are the benefits of each amino acid. So as I've already said that 20 amino acids are the essential amino acids, and they are used in protein synthesis. So first we shall be discussing the 20 amino acids, and then I'll also take up three more amino acids which have been recently discovered. So now when I talk of glycine, then please remember glycine is the simplest amino acid, and it was discovered by Henry Breckenaught in 1820, and he obtained it from protein gelatin by acidic hydrolysis. That is, when he did acidic hydrolysis of protein gelatin, he was able to get amino acid, which is glycine. And if we talk of the IUPAC name of glycine, then what we see is that the longest carbon chain has two carbons in it, and then at the alpha carbon we have an amino group, so we name it as 2-amino acetic acid. Now, what are the uses of glycine? Glycine helps in the formation of muscle tissue. And the second very important use of glycine is that it helps in converting glucose into energy, and it also protects us against some cancers. And the rich source of glycine is fish, meat, milk, cheese and beans. The next amino acid is alanine. And alanine was discovered, was synthesized by Adolf Strecker in 1850, which is also known as Strecker synthesis. And now it is used extensively in preparing amino acids in laboratory. What Strecker did was he treated acetaldehyde with ammonia and HCN when he was able to get 2-aminopropanoic acid. And what we find in case of alanine is that the side chain here is methyl, and it is again a non-polar amino acid because it is the hydrocarbon chain is present here. And the abbreviation for alanine is the first three letters ALA, and the one letter symbol for alanine is A. So when we talk of alanine, then what we know is that alanine is found in human plasma in free state. It also, like glycine, converts glucose into energy, and it eliminates excess of toxins from liver, and it also reduces cholesterol. So that means for the healthy functioning of liver and for detoxifying the body, what we require is alanine. And again, alanine is rich in foods like eggs, dairy products, fish and avocado. The next amino acid was valine, which is again a non-polar amino acid, and this is a branched amino acid. And what we find here is that Emil Fischer in 1901 obtained it by hydrolyzing casein, and he was able to obtain 2-amino-3-methylbutanoic acid. Now when I talk of valeric acid, valine, so we name it from valeric acid because it is having 5 carbons in it. And what you have to remember is valinine is one of an amino acid in which the side chain is branched. So, and if you have to remember the structure, please remember, it is very simple to remember the structure when we are remembering the structure of valine. That is, we have to write down inverted V. And when we write down inverted V, you will get the structure of valine. Because first, the basic structure is the same of an amino acid. That is, it has a carboxylic group, hydrogen and an amino. And the group attached to it is isopropyl, which we write in a form of a inverted V. Now, as I've already said, that it is a branched alkyl chain amino acid. And it is an essential amino acid, and it provides a stimulant effect. That is, it activates our brain, and it is very important for smooth nervous system and power of thinking. So it increases our power of thinking also, and for also correlating things. And the rich sources of valine are kidney beans, leafy vegetables, poultry and milk. The next amino acid is leucine. And leucine is again represented by LEU, the first three letter words, the abbreviation, and its symbol is L. Now, if you look into the side chain, which I have again colored with a pink color here, this is iso group here, isobutyl group here. But please remember, again, leucine, what you can remember leucine is that we are talking of valine, and in that case, we are just adding one more CH2 group, that is, this is an isobutyl group. And it was discovered in its impure form from cheese in 1819, and its crystalline form from mussels and wool in 1820. And as you can look at the structure, what we find is that the IUPAC name of the compound is 2S. When we are writing, in most of the cases, we are writing 2S. What I mean by saying by 2S is that configuration at the chiral carbon is S. And the name of this amino acid is 2-amino-4-methylpentanoic acid. And now leucine is again an essential amino acid, and this amino acid is very important because it helps in regulating the blood sugar levels, and it even promotes growth, and it helps in the recovery of muscles and bone tissues, as well as it helps in the production of growth hormone. And the next amino acid is now isoleucine. So when I talk of isoleucine, then isoleucine is again represented by three letters, I-L-E, and its symbol is I. And it was isolated by Ehrlich in 1904, and its composition was established 3 years later. Now, this isoleucine has two chiral carbons, and around both the chiral carbons, that is the second chiral carbon and the third carbon is the chiral carbon. And around both the carbons, the configuration will be S. So we've written 2S3S, and then we have 2-amino-3-methylpentanoic acid. Now see the ambiguity here. We are naming as isoleucine. So one would immediately come to your mind that the group is going to be iso. But in this case, what we find is that the group is not iso, but the butyl group present here is a secondary butyl group. Right? Whereas when we were talking of leucine, then in that case, as I said, In case of leucine, the structure of this group was a iso group, that the group is a secondary alkyl group. So now let us go on to the uses of isoleucine. Isoleucine is an essential amino acid, and its primary function is to boost up energy levels. So like if we are doing some exercise, and when we are doing some exercise, we are burning extra calories. So what does it? It converts more of glucose into energy, and it is able to increase the endurance, and it also helps in muscle tissue. Now we've seen that the three amino acids, which is isoleucine, leucine and valine, these are having branched chain amino acids, and they're having branched alkyl chain. That is, in vinyl we have a isopropyl group. In leucine, we have an isobutyl group. And if I talk of isoleucine, we have a secondary butyl group. And they constitute nearly 70% of all amino acids in the protein bodies. And they stimulate the anabolic functions. Now, the next two amino acids that I am going to discuss are serine and threonine. And serine and threonine are polar amino acids which are not charged, and they are hydroxyl group. That in these cases the side group is a hydroxyl. The hydroxyl group is present in the side chain, and this was isolated for the first time in 1865 from sericin, a silk protein. And when I talk of serine, and we can say that this serine is a derivative of alanine, that is, in this case we have a substituted alanine group, that is substituted methyl group. And when we talk of the functions of serine, then what we find is it is functionally important in many proteins. It is involved in biosynthesis of purines and pyrimidines, which are present in DNAs and RNAs. It is also important for creatine and porphyrin. You know, porphyrin rings are present in hemoglobin and chlorophyll. And this serine is required for the metabolism of fats, membranes, and muscle growth. It is also important for healthy immune system. As I've already said, serine is a hydroxy amino acid, and it is a derivative of alanine, in which we have a methyl substituted hydroxyl group. The next hydroxyl group in amino acid is present in threonine. As we can see here, that we are representing threonine with a three-lettered word, which is THR, and its one-letter symbol is T. It was isolated by William Cumin Ross in 1935. And this is the last essential dietary amino acid to be identified. It was said then that it is the last dietary essential amino acid, which was discovered in 1935. And again, in this case, we have two chiral carbons. And when we have two chiral carbons, in this case, what we find is that when we are saying it is 2S3R, that is configuration at the second chiral carbon, that is the carbon which is attached to amino, hydrogen, and the carboxylic group, is having S configuration, whereas the third carbon is having R configuration. And if we look into the side chain here, then what we find here is that the side chain is a hydroxy substituted ethyl chain here. So the name of this amino acid is, if I talk of the IUPAC name, then it is 2-amino-3-hydroxybutanoic acid. And this amino acid is very important since it supports the human immune system by helping in the production of antibodies. And you know, antibodies are very important. So if we catch up some infection, the body produces antibodies, and these antibodies help us to fight against the infection. Not only this, it also supports the central nervous system, our heart function, that is cardiovascular, liver and immune system functioning. It helps in the production of collagen and elastin and muscle tissue. So that means it is responsible for our, I'll give you a very silly example here, but which I think you're going to remember. That is, in the old age, when our skin, facial skin starts sagging, it is because the collagen starts to break down. So this particular amino acid helps in the production of collagen, and it gives elasticity to our muscles. And it also helps in building strong bones and tooth enamel, and speeds up the wound treating healing process. It is present in foods like fish, meat, cheese, beans, and almonds, and we can say peas also. And the next very important amino acid is methionine. And as we can say, we are representing methionine with word MET, the three-letter abbreviation, and the one-letter symbol is M. And please remember, we have two amino acids, which is methionine and cysteine, which are sulfur-containing amino acids. And when I talk of this amino acid, then we say it has a mercaptan group, that is, it has a sulfur group in it. And this was discovered by J.H. Mueller in 1922. It has only one chiral carbon, where the configuration is 2S, and the IUPAC name of this compound is 2-amino-4-methylsulfonylbutanoic acid. Why are we saying 4-methyl? Because if you start numbering from COH group, then what we find is at the fourth carbon, methyl sulfonyl group is attached at the fourth carbon, and the side chain in this case is having a sulfur group in it, and this is methionine. Now, methionine is again a very essential amino acid, and it is a sulfur containing amino acid, which is very important for protein synthesis, and it is an intermediate in biosynthesis of different phospholipids also. It also helps in the detoxification in liver. It is present in meat, fish, and dairy products. Also, whole wheats also whole grains also have this methionine in it. Now, cysteine is another sulfur-containing non-essential amino acid. You know what is non-essential amino acid? That is, it can be synthesized by the body. It again has only one chiral carbon, which is having R configuration, and we have a thiol group in it, that is the SH group. It is, again, we can consider cysteine to be a derivative of allylene, in which one hydrogen has been replaced with an SH group, that is the thiol group. Now, cysteine will provide us resistance to the body against all harmful effects. And how does it do so? Because it is responsible for building up white blood cell activity. And since if we know whenever we have infection, what happens is our WBCs go up. That is, they help in fighting the bacteria or the virus or any infection that we've got. And not only this, cysteine also helps in the skin functioning. And it is, again, as I've said, it is a non-essential amino acid. That is, the body can synthesize it. Not only this, we can also obtain this cysteine from high protein foods like pork, chicken, eggs, milk, cottage, and vegetarians can get it from garlic, granola, and onions and cheese. Now we are going to talk of acidic amino acids. When we talk of acidic amino acids, we have two, aspartate and glutamate. Now, if I talk of aspartate, what we've seen here is, in case of aspartate, the three letter abbreviation is ASP and its one letter symbol is D. See, now what I've already said, like if I talk of allylene, then in case of allylene, the one three letter was ALA, and there we were using one letter symbol as A. So for allylene, since the one letter symbol is A, for aspartate it has to be something different. So aspartate is represented by D. So what you have to remember is that if in a polypeptide chain we have A symbol, that means it is representing allylene, and if we have symbol D, it is representing aspartate. Now, aspartate was discovered in 1868 from legume plants. Not only this, now if I'm looking into the structure of aspartate, when I say it is an acidic amino acid, what I mean here is that it has two carboxylic groups. And if these carboxylic groups are protonated, then it is known as aspartic acid. And again, it is having S configuration at the second carbon, and the name is 2-aminobutane dioic acid. Now, aspartate is again a non-essential amino acid, that is, body can synthesize it. It is also widely distributed in proteins. It plays a major role in body energy cycle. That is, it will help in converting ATP to ADP, and it is necessary for stamina for doing extra work, and it is useful for making brain and the natural health. And it is very, very important in the functioning of RNA, DNA, that is, in the nucleic acids, and it also helps in the production of immunoglobulins and antibody synthesis. It is rich in food sources such as dairy, beef, poultry, sugarcane, and molasses. Now, the second acidic amino acid is glutamate. And now, again, we are going to, please remember, glutamate will be represented by a three-letter word abbreviation, which is GLU, and for it the symbol is E, one letter symbol is E, whereas if we talk of glycine, then for glycine the one letter symbol is G. And so that means if we have G, that is indicating in a polypeptide chain that glycine is present, and if we have E, that means glutamate is present. And this was discovered by Karl Rithausen in 1866, and it was first isolated from wheat gluten, and therefore it was named as glutamate. It is one of the most common non-essential amino acids. Again, it has two carboxylic groups, and at the second carbon, the configuration is S, and in the longest carbon chain, it has 5 carbons, so the IUPAC name will become 2-aminopentane dioic acid, since it has two carboxylic group. And as you can see here, the side chain has a carboxylic group here. So this is an acidic amino acid. Now, glutamate is a non-essential amino acid. That means body can also produce it. This is an amino acid which is an excitatory neurotransmitter that is increasing the firing of neurons in the human central nervous system, brain, and in spinal cord. What I mean here by saying that it is an excitatory neurotransmitter, that is, this amino acid helps us in fighting against stress. It will excite our neurons and our nervous system to fight against the stress that we have, and it will excite us.